Landing a starship is your first best destiny. Anything else is a waste of material.
Were I to invoke logic, logic clearly dictates that the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
Or the one.
You are my superior officer. You are also my friend. I have been and always shall be yours.
Mr. Spock convincing Admiral Kirk to once again take command of the Starship Enterprise in its latest adventure, Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, one of the four big summer movies that we'll be reviewing this week on Sneak Previews. Across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And this is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. In addition to Star Trek II, we'll also be reviewing two big new musicals, Annie and Grease 2. But first, Gene starts with a little Hanky Panky.
Well, it can be described in one word, and the word is cute. Hanky Panky with Gene Wilder and Gilda Radner is a screwball comedy about that old standby, the innocent man wrongly accused. The movie begins with Wilder accidentally getting involved with a woman who has a magnetic tape with important national security secrets on it. She's killed, Wilder is suspect, and then he hooks up with Gilda Radner, and soon they are both on the run from the police.
Oh, it was nice meeting you, Michael. I hope everything works out.
Where are you going? You can't go. They'll blame this one on me, too. Will you wait a minute?
No, I was just trying to help.
You're the only alibi I've got. You understand that if the police come in... Give me a key.
What?
Give me a key to the apartment.
Oh, Lord. Wait a minute.
They're coming.
No.
How can you get the key if you don't open the purse? You gotta open it. What the hell have you got?
Get out of my purse! I'm looking for it.
I gotta get out of here.
Mind if I join you?
Where are we?
Come on, this way. Come on, this way. I got a car a couple blocks away. Come on. Act normal.
I gotta get some clothes.
Cute, right? Well, the whole movie is that way, combining a solid amount of tension and comedy. This next scene is the funniest one in the movie, as Wilder and Radner are now on the run, actually on the fly, in a plane over the Grand Canyon with a pilot who is no longer in control.
Mr. Hogan, are you all right?
Of course he's all right. What are you asking stupid questions for? He's fine.
Michael is dead.
He is not dead. Don't say he's dead. The man is resting.
Look at him!
I don't have to look at him. He gave me a gas. He's having a gas attack.
Oh my God!
Yes. I see a rock. He's the best at doing that. I wasn't expecting much, though, when I went to see this film, because Wilder previously has seemed excessively frantic in a lot of his roles, almost manic. Radner has been in only one other film, a miserable comedy called First Family, so I wasn't expecting much. But together, in this script, directed by Sidney Poitier, it really all works. Tension, not too much comedy, and above all, Hanky Panky is cute.
I was surprised too.
Yeah.
After sitting there for 5 or 10 minutes, I wasn't expecting too much because I could immediately identify the genre, which is everybody's going to have a case of mistaken identity. They'll chase the wrong man. Everybody will be after the wrong thing.
Right.
Everybody will be across purposes. What happens in a movie like this when you more or less know what expectations you have for the plot is that everything depends on the performances.
Mm.
And Wilder was good, and Gilda Radner was good. You know, Wilder, you're right. Sometimes he seems to act as if his toe is stuck in an electric socket off the camera or something.
And
this time, he was just right.
I think the direction, Sidney Poitier, he did Stir Crazy, now this film, I thought the direction was actually a little tight. And I felt that the film didn't dissolve into just silliness, but you felt that the characters were in jeopardy. And I was very surprised. I also noticed with Poitier directing, there were a lot more black people in supporting roles, in minor roles, in crowd scenes. Mm-hmm. And I think that sends a clue, which is that if there's going to be a change around, as we had hoped, in employment of black people in the film industry, it's going to take some black directors to
We still think of him as an actor, and this is his sixth or seventh credit, and it's a very good job of comedy directing. And comedy directing is harder sometimes.
I agree.
Serious
I was
directing.
Caught by surprise and I liked it.
Our next film is Annie, which is one of the most expensive musicals ever made, and it sure looks like it. The sets in this movie are sumptuous. The production numbers are sensational. Daddy Warbucks Mansion looks like the First National Bank. It looks great even when it's not so entertaining. The movie stars Eileen Quinn as little orphan Annie, the plucky heroine of the famous comic strip that combined right-wing politics with a cliffhanging series of emergencies every week, every Sunday, week after week. Here's a scene from early in the movie where Annie defends her dog, Sandy, against some mean little boys. She's got the true grit. You get the idea there that Annie can really take care of herself. Annie lives in an orphanage that's ruled over by a stern dictator, Miss Hannigan, played by Carol Burnett, as kind of a cross between Cinderella's stepmother and Dudley Moore's Arthur. She's drunk all through the movie. Kind of funny. One day, the orphanage is visited by Daddy Warbuck's secretary, played by Anne Reinking.
Miss Hannigan, I am the private secretary to Oliver Warbuck.
See, Oliver Warbuck? Oliver Warbuck's the millionaire?
Oh, no, Oliver Warbuck's the billionaire.
Mary, mother, God.
Mr. Warbuck would like to invite an orphan to spend the week with him in his home. I'm here to select one.
Well, that's wonderful. What kind of an orphan did he have in mind?
Oh, well, friendly. Intelligent.
M-I, double S-I, double P-I.
And happy.
After a shaky start together, Annie and Warbucks get along just fine.
Cute little finger, you made life a song. You made me the singer. But you.
Yesterday was plain awful.
You can say that again.
Yesterday was plain awful.
But that's
it. Now,
that's it.
The British actor Albert Finney is Daddy Warbucks. Kind of an unexpected casting, but he's really pretty good in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that musical number gives you something of the flavor of Annie, which is wholesome, cheerful, upbeat, and relentlessly energetic. I was exhausted after I saw this movie. Eileen Quinn is at the center of everything, is Annie. She's a tirelessly efficient and talented little girl, sort of a miniature Ethel Merman, real trooper out there, pounding away on the boards. But she's right for this movie, which is flashy, slick, superficial, and entertaining. I didn't believe in the movie for one moment. I didn't really care about little orphan Annie. I never believed she was really in very much trouble, and yet somehow I guess I did enjoy the movie in a silly, superficial way. Annie is like a brainless toy. You wind it up, it goes around and around. You can't do anything with it, but it's fun to watch.
I am really of two minds on this picture. Mm-hmm. I disagree with you on a lot of the things that you liked about the film. I don't think the little girl was particularly interesting. She
really?
Couldn't sing very well. I thought that the sets, and especially, of course, the orphanage isn't supposed to look attractive, but I thought it sort of deadened the picture. And at the same time, I know what you're saying, I have sort of a grudging enjoyment of the film because of Albert Finney. Mm-hmm. I thought that he just stole the movie and that it became not the story of this little girl and whether she's going to make it or not. That's a given, as you mentioned.
But Daddy Warbucks changing from a cold, heartless kind of person to a lover of orphans.
Yeah, and I found that very appealing. And I watched this movie for him, and I recommend it for him, to see him take a role and see a real actor, because Finney is certainly that, transform an entire movie away from a little girl to a story of a man.
So I didn't get this. Did you like the movie or not?
There are lots of things I didn't like. I didn't think it was good as it should have been. I expected something on the order of My Fair Lady, a great musical on film, and yet I still enjoyed it.
I'm right on the fence, too, a kind of grudging admiration. It just, really taken off, it would have been a little more light-footed, a little more cheerful.
They blew it, everybody except Albert Finney.
Okay.
Our next film was a very pleasant surprise. It's the new Star Trek movie called Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan. And as with Hanky Panky, I went in with very low expectations because I don't particularly like science fiction. I was never a fan of the Star Trek TV show. Mm-hmm. And most importantly, I thought the first Star Trek movie was a worthless bore. Not this time, though. The new film is full of rich characterizations, strong emotions, and a story that is entertaining and touching at the end. The new film concerns another venture of the Starship Enterprise going into combat against the evil creature Khan, played by Ricardo Montalban, who is in the process of stealing a secret life-giving process called Genesis. Here's a scene where the Enterprise swings into action with Admiral Kirk and the regular crew in control, with one major addition, a Vulcan woman.
This is Starfleet operations. Enterprise is clear for departure.
Admiral on the bridge.
Pre-stage Foxchiller port.
On.
Pre-stage Foxchiller starboard.
On.
Main stage Foxchiller port.
Enabled.
Running lights
main
on.
Main stage Foxchiller starboard.
Enabled.
Intercooler status.
Standby.
Space.
Very well, Mr.
Savage.
You may clear all moorings.
Aye, sir.
Check.
Air equalization automatic.
Check.
All moorings are clear, Captain.
Thank you.
Battery relay
check.
Lieutenant, have you ever piloted a starship out of space dock?
Never, sir.
Take her out, Mr. Savick.
Aye, sir.
For everything, there is a first time, Lieutenant. Don't you agree, Admiral?
Mm-hmm. Aft thrusters, Mr. Sulu.
Aft thrusters.
Would you like a tranquilizer?
I had 1/4 impulse power.
And 1/4 impulse
of majestic, and that's really the tone of this picture. The action now gets more fierce as the Enterprise comes under direct attack by the evil Khan, Ricardo Montalban, who claims that Kirk, William Shatner, left him and his family marooned on an island, but Kirk is surprised by the attack.
They knew exactly where to hit us. Who knew where to hit us? And why? One thing is certain. We cannot escape on auxiliary power.
Visual. Sulu, divert all power to phasers.
Too late.
Hang on!
Scotty! What's left?
Just the battery, sir. I can have auxiliary power in a few minutes.
We don't have a few minutes!
you give me phaser power?
A few shots, sir.
Not enough against their shields.
What the hell are they?
Admiral, the commander of the Reliant is signaling. He wishes to discuss terms of our surrender.
Khan is able to put two of Kirk's allies out of commission, but he doesn't kill Kirk, and he doesn't want to, yet.
Kirk, you're still alive, my old friend.
Still, old friend. You managed to kill just about everyone else, but like a poor marksman, you keep missing the target.
Perhaps I no longer need to try.
Oh, no!
The droid can't take it!
Come. Khan, you've got Genesis.
But you don't have me. You are going to kill me, Khan. You're going to have to come down here. You're going to have to come down here.
I've done far worse than kill you. I've hurt you. And I wish to go on hurting you. I shall leave you as you left me, as you left her. Marooned for all eternity in the center of a dead planet. Buried alive. Buried alive.
Khan!
Khan! What's most entertaining about this movie is its broad and heroic style. You can even hear it in the music there, personified most by Admiral Kirk, beautifully played by William Shatner. He's relaxed, confident, good-humored, and brave. That's an old-fashioned character with old-fashioned movie hero traits. In a strong film, it also really has those same traits. It's relaxed, it's confident, it's good-humored. I thoroughly enjoyed this film from start to finish.
This is the Star Trek movie they should have made the first
time. You better
believe it. I am a fan of the TV series, and this is the kind of movie I was waiting for. It has the two things Star Trek was always best at, ideas and character development. Mm-hmm. Star Wars, those types of movies, are basically action and special effects. Mm-hmm. This Star Trek movie has the Genesis idea. It has that really nice relationship between Mr. Spock and Captain Kirk, never developed more fully than in this movie.
Right.
And then Ricardo Montalban.
Surprising.
He gives Star Trek what it needed all along, the two movies anyway, a really colorful, interesting villain. He's the Darth Vader of Star Trek. It's just what they needed.
Yeah, and I like that they went with more standard, low-key special effects, that beam. Mm-hmm. Just that beam, and it's amazing. I mean, I don't know how they exactly do that. But it's amazing enough, but it's done of a style of maybe 15, 20 years ago. Amazing. And I just thought that this film was a throwback to a solid kind of entertainment as opposed to a flashy pinball exercise.
When you mention those special effects, don't you always find it amusing that they have the technology to travel between the stars and yet they can never really knock out another ship?
Yes.
Just a close hit, you know, and there's a lot of smoke and they're shaking up a little bit.
There's smoke always there, but it hasn't come through anything. You know, that's another problem, too. No hole in the ceiling.
Lots of damage. We'll have to repair the ship. And the next shot, it's always repaired.
Very entertaining film.
Now we come to a sequel to another big box office hit. This one is called Grease 2. It's set in 1961. It's not really a sequel since it doesn't have the same stars or follow the same characters as the original Grease. I guess it's more of a retread. The movie takes us back to Rydell High for more mindless nonsense involving the greasers, the teachers, and the wholesome students. But there's one major difference in Grease 2, though. The original Grease was about class warfare between the greasers and the preppies, but this movie has everybody on the same side. They're all working for the same choreographer. Here's a scene, for example, where the school's motorcycle gang rehearses for the high school talent show.
I think we could all use a little guaranteed all-the-way action. And I know just the place.
Well, come on and tell us, Johnny, what's the secret of success?
You gotta take a tip from the king of hip, 'cause you know that he's the best.
Thank you.
I think you can see what I mean there by the lack of class warfare in the movie. When the motorcycle gang is appearing in the senior talent show, or whatever it's called, I don't think John Travolta would have gotten involved in those kinds of goody activities in the first movie. But anyway, that biker gang is known as the T-Birds. And they have a ladies' auxiliary made up of their girlfriends. They're called the Pink Ladies. And there's a rule, pink ladies only date T-Birds, until one day this preppy from Australia turns up and spots the president of the Pink Ladies, and it's love at first sight.
So how's your first week been?
Oh, great. Yours?
Oh, listen, there's such a fascinating world of chemistry out there.
Yeah, I know. Hey, how would you know that Stephanie Zanoni?
Stephanie Zanoni is one of my very best... Uh-oh, Michael. I think there's something you don't understand. You see, Stephanie Zanoni is a pink lady, which means if you're not a T-Bird, which you are not, you can look, but don't touch. Michael, I wouldn't even look.
Well, then how'd you become one of these T-Birds, then? Hey?
The two stars of the movie are Maxwell Caulfield and Michelle Pfeiffer, who play Stephanie Zanoni, the one who was walking away by the fence. It's inevitable they're going to be compared with John Travolta and Olivia Newton-John, and are they as good? Well, Pfeiffer has some of the same electricity as Newton-John, but Maxwell Caulfield is no John Travolta, and what's worse, he doesn't even dance much in this movie. I thought Grease was about dancing, practically. The plot is really dumb. To win the Pink Lady's admiration, Caulfield puts on a mask and appears as the mystery motorcyclist, jumping his motorcycle over old Studebakers at high school hops. It seems like an hour goes by, though, before the woman finally figures out who this guy is. She can only see him, you see, from the bottom of the face down. The plot wouldn't be so bad if the movie had more life, but it has forgettable songs, choreography that looks like crowd control, and for that matter, not very much Grease.
Well, I'll compare the two, and I don't think that they stack up well at all for another reason. Singing ability.
Well,
this woman, you say, has some of the same electricity. She's pretty. I don't think much more than that. And she can't sing like Olivia Newton-John. The film doesn't have the same songs as the first film. First film had a number of very memorable songs, huge hits. I can't remember a single song from this film.
So we have a man who can't dance like Travolta, a woman who cannot sing like Olivia Newton-John, songs that are no good.
Yeah, at the same time, I think I liked it a little bit more than you because it was sort of an homage to the biker. And I find that myth appealing, and I found that the film got a lot of its power just by introducing the character of this heroic biker image.
The question,
but I don't think it's a
the question I had, why did Grease 2 have to be a total remake of the first one with very little invention and not a new story and not really a different era? Why not advance it 10 years to 1969 or 1979 or make it punks versus the faculty? Anything other than just the same stuff recycled again.
They play it safe.
Oh, here he is, Sparky the Wonder Dog, leaping into the balcony to help us pick out the dogs of the week's worst movies.
More like a sneeze than a bark there. My dog this week is yet another mad slasher movie. This one is called Visiting Hours, starring William Shatner and also Lee Grant as a TV broadcaster who enters a hospital after a creep attacks her because he doesn't like her strong opinions, doesn't like aggressive women. Why? It turns out that his mother once threw boiling water on his father. Too bad she picked the wrong man in the family to douse. Visiting Hours consists of nothing more than the slasher stalking Lee Grant in a hospital. Along the way, he suffocates an old woman, tortures a little girl, and repeatedly sticks a knife into the belly of a young nurse. A sick film, and for the life of me, I don't understand why an actress of the caliber of Lee Grant is in it, or an actor of the caliber of William Shatner is in it. I guess it's money. It's too bad.
It is too bad. My dog of the week this week doesn't go, the award doesn't go to a movie, Gene, it goes to a Hollywood studio. I'm giving Universal Pictures the dog of the week award because of their decision to withdraw a movie named Barbarossa from release before it ever had a chance to really prove itself. The movie was directed by Fred Shepsey, the Australian filmmaker who made a brilliant film called The Chant of Jimmy Blacksmith. And the movie stars Gary Busey, remember him from the Buddy Holly story, he won an Oscar nomination. And Willie Nelson, the country outlaw, is a legendary Western outlaw. So there's one of my favorite directors, two of my favorite actors. And what's more, Gene, I've read about this movie in a review by you. You gave it a good review in the Chicago Tribune.
Yeah, I thought it was terrific. But, you know, I had to drive 50 miles to Michigan City, Indiana, to see this in an indoor theater. They had thrown it away in just a half a dozen drive-ins.
Well, anyway, I was at the Cannes Film Festival when it played here. When I asked for a chance to see the movie so we could review it on sneak previews, Universal's response was that the movie had been pulled out of release and put on the shelf, said the movie wasn't making it. I say, give this movie a chance. Right. Could it possibly be that somebody at Universal, an executive, didn't want to see the movie succeed once they reached an executive decision that it wasn't going to make it. I think that's really too bad. And I say, if Universal wants me to withdraw my Dog of the Week award, show me this movie.
Okay, well, I hope they do, and I think you'd really enjoy it. It's terrific. So much for the dogs. Now to recap the main movies on this show. Both Roger and I thought Hanky Panky with Gene Wilder and Gilda Radner was a cute screwball comedy. Two yes votes for that, meaning yes, we both can recommend you see it. On Annie, strange reviews. Roger found the movie brainless but fun. I like Albert Finney in the movie a lot, but I thought the film looked bad and that Annie was a bore. So two grudging, reluctant yes votes for Annie. And two strong yes votes for Star Trek II, the latest adventure of the Starship Enterprise. This one is much better than the first Star Trek movie. And two no votes for Grease 2, the lame sequel that has no memorable songs and no stars equal to Olivia Newton-John and John Travolta. I like the new one a little bit more than Roger, but still, two no votes nonetheless.
So, Star Trek 2 and Hanky Panky, yes, right?
Right.
Okay, that's all for this week. Join us next time on Sneak Previews. We'll be back with more new movies, including Clint Eastwood in a new adventure called Firefox, and Al Pacino as a Broadway playwright in Author. Until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Funding for Sneak Previews was provided by this station and by other public television stations.